Final hour here on the Chad Hastie Show. We weren't planning on having our next guest on until next week, but you know, some things change when it comes to Texas politics. Joining us on the phones right now, our good friend, editor of the Quorum Report, Scott Braddock. Scott, good morning. How are you?
Morning, Chad. I was reminded of when I was a disc jockey at 17 years old in Brenham, Texas, and I worked with a guy who, you know, when people work in radio, as you know all too well, the careers can be interesting because people have all sorts of jobs to supplement their income. And one of the guys I worked with was a prison guard in Huntsville. And he said, you know, sometimes this news thing and the DJ thing, radio thing, it's like being a prison guard. It's about 99% boredom and 1% sheer terror, because you never know when something's going to happen. you always have to be on watch.
That's true.
You know, for what may go down.
That's true. And something did go down yesterday. Are we calling this a gate yet? I'm unofficially calling it credential gate, but I don't know. Yeah. I don't know if that'll stick or not. Scott, we had a story that broke yesterday, and one of the players in the story is actually one of the main players in the story, and he kind of broke the story himself. Break this down, because we've got Michael Quinn Sullivan of Empower Texans, we've got Speaker Dennis Bonin, and we have Chairman Dustin Burroughs all wrapped into this one story that one would think never would have happened in the first place.
You would think it's astonishing that Speaker Dennis Bonin, who started out the year saying that he would, quote, sure as hell never going to waste his time in trying to appease Empower Texans. That's the way he talks about them. Astonishing that he would have a meeting with them at all, right,
The
Speaker's office. But apparently that did happen. And Michael Quinn Sullivan, the spokesman for Tim Dunn's Empower Texans, wrote about it on their website on the Texas Scorecard yesterday. And his claim is that the Speaker and Burroughs wanted Empower Texans to target certain Republicans in their primaries next year in exchange for media credentials for the Texas House floor. Of course, Empower Texans has been denied media credentials over and over again, and they're in court about that. Actually, they're in federal court trying to beat Texas House leadership to be able to have access to the floor during legislative proceedings. The reason they have been denied so far, by the way, is because they are a lobby group and because they operate a political action committee, which spends money to either elect or defeat candidates. The Speaker of the House is not commenting on this, at least to us in the media, and Chairman Burroughs has gone silent. He hasn't said anything about it publicly. The Speaker did send a letter to Sullivan in which he essentially said that Sullivan does not remember the meeting correctly, but there's been no on-the-record denial from the Speaker about any of this to those of us in the media. And I'm hearing that folks at Breitbart, for example, are interested in promoting this storyline if it is true. Brandon Darby over at Breitbart Texas said that if true, it's very bad and will rock the Texas GOP. If accurate, I will help make sure it rocks the Texas GOP. One thing I would add to this, Chad, is that by naming 10 Republican members of the House who are now on this alleged target list of the Speaker, that basically Empower Texans may be sort of setting the stage for what they always said was the former Speaker Joe Strauss's original sin, which was joining with Democrats to elect a Speaker. We are looking at an election that's coming up in 2020 where we may see Republicans lose seats again in the Texas House like they did in 2018. They lost 12 in the House last year, and Democrats could pick up seats again. Remember, in 2009, the split in the House was a very narrow majority for the Republicans, 76-74, and that enabled some Republicans to join with Democrats to get rid of the former Speaker, Tom Craddock, and install Joe Strauss. And then the accusation forever from Empower Texans for the next decade was that he had, you know, committed the sin of working with known Democrats to become the Speaker. You would think that they may have given us an outline here of 10 Republicans who would join with some Democrats to maybe elect some other Republican Speaker coming up in the 2021 session of the legislature.
Yeah. Ooh. Okay, so there's a lot to digest.
Standing it all the way up.
But there's a lot to digest here. So what is Burroughs's role in all of this?
Burroughs, as the chairman of the Texas House Republican Caucus, is said to have been the one to tell Sullivan who the 10 members were that were to be targeted in these Republican primaries. The underlying problem that the Speaker and Burroughs supposedly had with these members is that they voted against the pared-down ban on taxpayer lobbying, which was on the floor of the Texas House during the session. Although that seems a little strange to me because there were more than that who voted. There were more Republicans than that who voted against that.
Right.
That seems to be the litmus test, at least according to the accusation from Michael Quinn Sullivan. By the way, I would say it is laughable that Sullivan is saying that Empower Texans is not for sale in this whole deal. That their group is above it all. When I don't accuse the folks of being for sale, but transactional politics is definitely at the heart of what the business model is for Empower Texans.
The 10 Republicans that are targeted, Michael Quinn Sullivan in his article said, and he was honest about it. He said, to be fair, these are 10 pretty good targets. I mean, these are 10 targets
that he would probably target anyway.
Right, and that's what I've seen on social media is that these are 10 people already that if Empower Texans were to go after in primary Republicans, these people would be like A-plus targets for Empower Texans anyway, right?
These are folks that they rate poorly on their scorecard that they do, after every legislative session. These are Republicans that they describe as squishy. I would not agree with that. But they are people that, and some of them folks that they have targeted in the past. And so the idea that they would be asked by someone else to go after these folks seems very interesting. It's yet to be seen what all the fallout is of this.
Yeah, okay, so let's we're right for the purpose of this interview, and let's just take everything at face value because we have not heard from anyone on the other side. We've only heard Michael Quinn Sullivan's position. We have not heard from the Speaker. We have not heard from Representative Burroughs. So, taking the story on face value, what's the win here for Bonin?
I'm trying to figure that out. Bonin has made his entire career as Speaker centered around the idea that he's unifying the Republican caucus and really unifying the entire Texas House, right? He was elected unanimously, and he was elected ostensibly to sort of put down and end the quote-unquote civil war within the Republican Party, uniting the factions that had been, fighting each other when Joe Strauss was the Speaker. And so as far as a win for him, I don't think that there is one. The Speaker on this question of whether there should be a ban on taxpayer lobbying, he was not right out front on this. And I can tell you that during the session, my sources suggested that the Speaker, in various meetings that were had either with the Republican caucus or with chairman in the House, that he never did really indicate one way or another whether he was in favor of this. However, as Chairman Burroughs pointed out, I believe on your show, the House leadership team did put that bill on a fast track to the floor of the House, even though it faced stiff opposition from the Austin lobbyists. And so, where the Speaker is on that question, not clear. But if he wanted to target members based on that issue, it would certainly be news to folks in Austin because they had been trying to figure out, folks here had been trying to figure out where exactly the Speaker is on it.
What's the impact, you think? I know Brandon Darby brought up that this would rock the Texas GOP.
Yeah.
Would it?
It's not clear. This is something that could have potentially destabilize the House. After the whole kumbaya session that we covered here on the radio for months, you notice all that's sort of coming to a close now, and we're getting back to Texas politics as usual, which is a full contact sport. If folks aren't ready for these kinds of accusations to be made or for nasty campaigns to unfold, then they are definitely new to Texas politics if they haven't seen this sort of stuff before. I think that going forward, it may mean that the war within the Republican Party is not over. Here's the way I would frame this. If this is true, and it's a high-stakes accusation. If it's true, then it does have the possibility of destabilizing the Republican caucus and perhaps Republicans considering someone else for Speaker. If a Speaker is really saying one thing, which is, remember, this is the Speaker who had said that no member of the House, Republican or Democrat, should be meddling in the races of other members, right?
Yeah.
If he is saying something different behind closed doors, and there is evidence of that, and let's remember that Empower Texans and allied organizations have a history of secretly recording office holders and staffers at the Texas Capitol. If they have a recording of it or some further proof that this is true, that could definitely upend everything that Bonin has worked to achieve.
Yeah.
At the same time, if it's not true and can be shown to not be true and is never substantiated, I would think that this might be the march into complete irrelevance for Empower Texans, because you can't make an accusation like this and then not back it up.
All right, and you brought up something I was about to ask you, which is, do you think anyone taped this? Because I don't know if Bonin would have taped it. I don't know if Bonin had like a video in his office. I don't know about that, but you just hit it with Empower Texans before. They know how to do undercover stuff.
Yes, they do, and it's not out of the realm of possibility, because we've seen this with various groups, that recordings can be selectively edited. As a radio professional, you know how audio equipment works. Things can be selectively edited to make things look one way when the reality was a different way, so we should say that. But if it was taped and if it can be shown, perhaps there's a tape of the whole meeting that people could hear, then I think that would have serious impact. Whether this really moves the needle going forward, and I would expect, based on everything I've heard over the last 12 hours or so, I would expect a sustained attack on this. I don't think it's going away anytime soon. It'll be important what the Speaker eventually says about it, if he does say anything about it. And we should say, again, that the Speaker did send a letter to Sullivan saying that Sullivan basically doesn't remember their meeting correctly.
Yeah.
But the Speaker has not said on the record what was actually said in the meeting. And again, to so many observers of Texas politics who first saw that this had happened, that there was a meeting, it's astonishing he met with them at all. It's really playing with fire.
Yeah, that was one of my initial thoughts. Scott, as we continue on with this, and like I said, I mean, there's a lot to unpack on this one topic alone.
Sure.
It seems as though a lot of folks on social media from different news organizations that cover Texas are approaching this with apprehension and not completely trusting what Michael Quinn Sullivan has put out there. And, you know, let's be honest, he's gotten some things right. He's gotten some things wrong. I remember even going back to, we'll localize it here for listeners here in Lubbock, when Chancellor Duncan had resigned here.
Oh, yeah.
I believe there was a tweet. I don't know if there was a story, but there was a tweet that Empower Texans had sent out, or the Texas scorecard had sent out, that it had something to do with, if I'm remembering right, they had accused, or they had sources that said that Duncan had done some irresponsible things with finances, correct?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, that's right. And
that was blown out of the water.
Blown out of the water. Not true. It can't be taken for granted that what they're saying is rock solid. And, I am all for citizen journalism and people, seeking the best attainable version of the truth, of course. And I think the Speaker, and look, here, it's not fair to say that if there's an accusation made, that a person has to prove that it's not true, right? That's not fair. That's not how our system of justice works, for sure. It should be on the person making the accusation to prove that it is true. And so if there is some recording, if there is some, if there are some actual notes from this meeting that were created at the time of the meeting, that would be something that might help substantiate this. I want to be really careful here, and we have a full write-up about this at quorumreport.com. The reason I'm being careful is because I have a duty to get it right, and I think you're taking that same approach. You want to make sure that whatever we report here on the radio is correct. I think with all of the questions that are being asked, It's probably incumbent on the speaker to say something, but I wouldn't shift the burden to him to say it's on you, Bonin, to prove that this isn't true. I would say it's on Sullivan and Empower Texans to prove that it is true, and we'll see what they come up with.
Can you hold on for one more break?
Absolutely.
Okay, we're going to continue this discussion when we come back. Back on the Chad Hasty Show, joining us right now, once again, editor of Quorum Report, Scott Braddock. And Scott, you've got an entire story written up at Quorum Report on this topic that we've been discussing. I want to ask you about the, I guess, another potential fallout. As someone who's, you're obviously, you're in the media, you have a lot of discussions with folks. Is there anything wrong, illegal, unethical with the, if the allegations are true, offering a press credential to get on the House floor? Is there anything illegal, unethical, whatever, about that offer, if that's true?
And to be clear, in Bonin's letter to Sullivan, he said that that is handled by someone else, not himself. He said that that's handled by House Administration and the chairman, Charlie Guerin. It would be a felony for an elected official to offer an official government action in exchange for the way that PAC money would be, political action committee money, would be spent. So that would be very, very serious, yeah. And I could imagine that there would be a criminal complaint about that if there was proof of it.
Yeah, I mean, that would be huge.
Very serious.
So
that's why I say the stakes are real high here, because if it was true, that obviously is a huge problem for the speaker. If it's just not true and can't be proven, that would really undermine the credibility of Empower Texans, which, as you pointed out in the last segment, has a history that is checkered when it comes to getting stuff right.
Okay. With Burroughs being in the room, any issues there? Again, the allegations are that Bonin made this offer. With Burroughs being in the room, how does he get wrapped up in this?
I'm not sure, and that's something to have some more conversations about. I think that Burroughs, according to this accusation, was the one who relayed to the Empower Texans folks which members of the House should be targets in the Republican primaries. And so he would definitely be a party to Burroughs would be a party to what had happened here, although I'm not entirely sure what the legal fallout would be from that.
Do you think the reason we haven't heard from Bonin yet, you think with the, because what Michael Quinn Sullivan is accusing him of at the end of the day is a felony. Do you think Bonin's talking to lawyers before he talks to the press?
It's possible. I also think that part of the calculation would be that this is coming from Empower Texans. This is coming from a group with a political agenda and that has been, politically against what both Speaker Strauss and Speaker Bonin have been trying to accomplish in office. And so it may be that they were hoping that Bonin and others were hoping that this would simply go away out of simply the fact that the people would not trust the source that it came from.
Scott, we got to get moving. QuorumReport.com, you got it all there.
Complete coverage right there, QuorumReport.com. Thanks, Chad.
Thank you, Scott.